Okay, so let me start. This talk is partially based on our recent preprint. So in principle, if anybody is interested, you're welcome to read it through. There are maybe more formulas and more text you need to explain things. Let me start from just one example of simulation where we have the spikes in order to explain what are they and why they can cause some issues in simulations. It's very simple example. Since we are here at ALF workshop, probably everybody knows what's going on. It's Hubbard model, and we are choosing to simulate it in SU2 symmetrical manner. So that we make transfer from spin up, spin down electrons to electrons and holes, and then we can couple discrete auxiliary field to charge, as it is shown here. Then we have, in principle, complex fermionic determinant, but fermionic determinants for electrons and holes are complex conjugate to each other, so we still do not have sign problem. Then general scheme of the updates. Again, I think everybody knows, but since in this talk it will be important subject, I mean exact order of updates and computation of observables, here I include this scheme just to remind how it works. We have our lattice, it's here, and these parallelograms are time slices of the lattice. Then in one sweep, we update auxiliary fields inside time slices step by step, so that inside time slice, well, normally if we have usual local updates, we update auxiliary fields at one side in this case, then we move to next side and so on and so forth. And then we go through first time slice, we move to the next time slice and so on. And then the whole sweep is when we go through the whole lattice. This is the scheme for updates. And when we compute observables, they are essentially computed in the same time slice where we are doing updates for auxiliary fields. And then we move to the next time slice, again do updates of the fields inside this time slice, and then when we are finished with these updates inside this time slice, we again compute all observables inside this time slice, and then we average all this the results inside time slices, and we get value of observable for the whole sweep. And this sweep is like individual step in our Markov chain Monte Carlo. And the next sweep is the next step in Markov chain. And what we will look on is the value of observable after we average over the whole sweep. It means that if you have local observable, for example, we average over all sites in space in each time slice and also over all time slices. And we look at history of this observable throughout the Markov chain process. Okay, so as I said, it's a Hubbard model in SU2 symmetrical simulation, and we look at charge fluctuations inside sublattice. This is history of this observable, and as I said, this is horizontal axis is basically number of sweep. And each
sorry,
point,
Maxim, short question. Yep. You're thinking about just a space observable, not the time.
Yes. In this talk, I will only talk about observables which are computed from equal time, functions.
Okay.
So, and each point on this plot is value of square charge in this case for current sweep. Well, as you see, generally these points are concentrated around some average value, but at some sweeps, at some configurations, we have values which are like two, even three orders of magnitude different from average value. And these are spikes. From this plot, I think it's relatively obvious why they are problematic. Because imagine we wait long enough. And then if you wait long enough, we in principle can encounter so huge spike that it will significantly shift the whole average for the whole process. It means that average converges very slowly, or in worst case scenario, it might not converge at all. That's why spikes are problematic, and that's why we are looking into ways to get rid of them. But this description is qualitative. We need some quantitative measure for spikes to work with them in more strict manner. So how can we formalize the spikes? We can use distributions for observables. I mean that from this history, we can plot histogram, how frequently we encounter values of observable in some small intervals, basically. So this histogram is plotted here using exactly the same coordinates as for the history. And one can see that usually points are indeed concentrated around average value. It's somewhere here, around the center of this, around the peak of the histogram. And these spikes, they manifest themselves as heavy tail of the distribution of observable. Well, it's relatively obvious. And then we can use these histograms to quantify spikes. Now let's have a look at these histograms more closely. Namely, what this heavy tail mean mathematically? Heavy tail means that instead of exponential decay, we have power law decay, which is significantly slower. And in the worst case, it may be slow enough to not even, that even mean value is not defined. Well, it's actually not the case here. Mean value is always well defined. But for example, next moments like dispersion can actually be not well defined for this heavy tail distribution. Okay, so here we look at the tail and we fit it with power law. Well, power law is some shift because, well, obviously distribution doesn't start at zero, so we need some shift to make better fit. And as you can see, power law indeed describes the data relatively well. Well, here, of course, the statistic is not good enough so that we do not have well-defined frequency of spikes in this region. But nevertheless, description with power law is relatively good. And this is essentially a heavy tail distribution. And one can see that with this power law, mean value is well-defined still, but dispersion is already not well-defined. And it means that strictly speaking, we cannot even apply standard statistical processing to this kind of distribution, and we need more elaborate statistical processing. I will talk about it later. Okay, now let's dive a bit into origin of the spikes, why they appear in quantum Monte Carlo, specifically in fermionic quantum Monte Carlo. I'm looking at the simplest toy model, which can already demonstrate appearance of this phenomena. It's one-side Hubbard model. When we do not have kinetic energy, we have only interacting term. Then we can make Gaussian Hubbard-Slatonovich decomposition for this interaction and arrive at very simple one-dimensional integral for partition function. It's here, and action is written here. Again, it's just function of one variable, one auxiliary field. Since we made Gaussian Hubbard-Slatonovich decomposition, we have this Gaussian term for auxiliary field, for the action of auxiliary field, and then we have logarithms of fermionic determinants. Now let's have a look at profile of the action. Profile of the action is divided into regions, and regions are separated one from another by zeros of fermionic determinants, because as one can easily see at these points, fermionic determinant goes to zero, logarithm, well, minus logarithm goes to plus infinity. It means that we have this kind of walls between these regions. Now what happens at these walls? Obviously, since action goes to infinity, probability goes to zero. So our Monte Carlo is naturally repelled from these points. At the plot for probability, we see that probability goes to zero at this point. But observable, fermionic observable, in this case, it's just propagator. Well, in this case, it's simply inverse determinant. Propagator goes to infinity exactly at the same points. It means just qualitatively that very rarely Monte Carlo can approach these points. Rarely, of course, because probability is small in the vicinity of them. But at these points, simultaneously, fermionic propagator goes to infinity. If qualitatively, it simply corresponds to this picture of spikes, that rarely we encounter some special configurations. And for them, for the special configurations, fermionic observables explode. So qualitatively, we can connect these spikes with zeros of determinants. Okay, this is toy model. How can we picture this phenomena for real simulations of Hubbard model? In principle, it also can be done. Here I make a small excursion into it. Again, let's look into Hubbard model in SU2 symmetrical Gaussian Hubbard Satonovich decomposition. It means that we have now continuous auxiliary fields. And again, we have a picture quite similar to the Stoy model. We have bosonic action, which is just Gaussian term, and we have fermionic determinants for electrons and holes. And we need the plot analogous to this plot for profile of action for one-dimensional toy model. And what can we do to plot some analog for this picture? Of course, we cannot plot full profile of the action, because now dimensionality of configuration space is really huge. It's like 10, 100,000 fields, so it's impossible to plot. But what we can do, we can still identify minima of the action. Then we can look at Hessian at this minima of the action and identify the directions of the fastest growth of the action starting from the saddle point. And these directions, they will correspond to eigenvectors for largest eigenvalues of Hessian. And these directions correspond to potentially the most severe spikes. Okay, this program can be done. Well, technical details are complicated, so I will not describe them, but in general, for real Hubbard model, this local minima of the action are some localized field configurations. They can be described as instantons, so that basic global minima is vacuum when all auxiliary fields are zero. Then we have one instanton. It means that we have all the fields except several fields in the vicinity of center of instanton, which are non-zero. So here is this instanton. Fields are non-zero around its center, and fields around it in the whole lattice are basically zero. And then we have two, this localized field configurations, and so on and so forth. And we can compute Hessian, we can diagonalize Hessian around, say, two instanton saddle point. in one-dimensional analog, it will be this saddle. And then we can identify eigenvectors for Hessian, which correspond to largest eigenvalues of Hessian. And we can plot profile of the action in the cross section defined by this two eigenvectors of Hessian. Now we have two-dimensional plot. It's easier to comprehend. So here is this operation made for two instanton saddle, and this point is two instanton saddle. And what is interesting is that the this eigenvectors of Hessian they actually coincide with instanton profiles. It means that this direction corresponds to simply removal of one of these two instantons. So for example, in this direction, when we are moving towards this direction, we are gradually removing one instanton. And here at this point, one instanton is removed and we remain just with another instanton. In this direction, we remove another instanton, the first one, and here we remove the second one. And finally, here we remove both instantons so that we arrive in vacuum. And what is interesting is that here you can see that action grows to infinity. Here we have actually analogs for these domain walls. Now they are two-dimensional in this cross section. And one can see that both two instanton saddle, one instanton saddles, and vacuum, they are separated from each other by this two-dimensional domain wall. So this is direct analog to this one-dimensional picture we had for toy model. And if we look at long-range spin-spin correlations, they are explode exactly along these domain walls. So essentially here, I just wanted to show that this picture we had in toy model, when we have explosion of fermionic observables simultaneously with these domain walls caused by zeros of determinants, is exactly repeated for real QMC simulations for Hubbard model, just in many dimensions that we have here, well, two-dimensional in this cross section, two-dimensional domain wall, and we have explosion of fermionic observables along this domain wall. Okay, so we have a question of what's instanton here. Instanton is this localized field configuration. I understand that it's maybe difficult to understand from this hand waving explanation, but really, unfortunately, I don't have enough time during this 1 hour talk to explain everything. Essentially, these field configurations are solutions for Euclidean evolution equations for the field, for auxiliary field, taking into account back reaction from fermionic determinants. That's why I think they can be called instantons. So they are not quite traditional ones. Okay, so as I said, we have domain walls caused by zeros of determinants, and spins and fermionic observables explode along the same domain walls. Okay, let's move further. Well, yeah, that's some backup slides. It shows that we can actually build instanton gas approximation for the Hubbard model and use it to predict properties of spectral functions. And it actually works quite well to a certain extent. Okay, now a little bit of math. Dimensionality of zeros of determinant, namely dimensionality of this domain walls in configuration space, can be connected to the power in the power law decay for this heavy tail distribution. How can it be done? Let's look formally into configuration space when we have domain wall. Here we have domain wall, and let's choose one coordinate which is perpendicular to this domain wall in its vicinity, at least, and all other n minus one coordinates they correspond to movement along this domain wall, so that we have a dimensionality of domain wall equal to n minus one. Now, how can we derive asymptotics of heavy tail distribution in this case? Let's look at cumulative distribution function for some observable theta. And cumulative distribution functions, it's just the probability that this observable is larger than some value. And that's why, since observable explodes, it goes to infinity along this domain wall, cumulative distribution function is defined by the behavior of probability distribution and observable in the vicinity of this domain wall. As I said, this is exactly because cumulative distribution function for large value of observable is defined by places in configuration space where this observable goes to infinity. Okay, in the vicinity of domain wall, probability distribution can be at least approximately described by this expression, because it goes to zero when this x1 goes to zero when we approach the domain wall, and then we have additional factor which is dependent on all other coordinates, and so this is behavior of observable in the vicinity of domain wall. Then taking into account these approximations, we can compute cumulative distribution function, at least asymptotics of cumulative distribution function, and from it we can go back to distribution for observable itself, and then we have this power law for the observable. So one can see that it is actually connected to dimensionality of domain walls, because here, if dimensionality of domain wall is n minus one, we have 5/2 as power, and if dimensionality of domain wall is n minus two, then one can repeat the same computations and arrive at power equal to 3, and so on and so forth. So that actually, if we decrease dimensionality of domain wall by one, power law acquires another 1/2 in the power. It actually means that the higher is dimensionality of the domain wall, the worse is behavior of this heavy tail distributions. Basically, the more zeros of determinant we have in configuration space, the worse are the spikes. And yeah, if you look at fit of this heavy tail distribution obtained from QMC data, then indeed it's reasonably close to 5/2. Difference is probably caused by the fact that we can have crossing of domain walls, so that dimensionality among this crossing is different than dimensionality of domain walls in general. And we can also check explicitly is that when we remove domain walls, when we remove zeros of determinant by mass term, they can actually be removed by this mass term, then these heavy tail distributions disappear completely. We have these distributions, and if we try to fit them with power law, fit simply does not converge. We do not have any minima for chi squared, and the power in the power law grows indefinitely. Let me look at the question. Yeah. Here it's not a problem because we are using discrete auxiliary fields, and we do not use like HMC, which uses Hamiltonian dynamics. That's so why
when you flip a discrete field, you can jump from one zero to the next area.
Yes, exactly. It's only HMC which has problems here because it uses Hamiltonian dynamics. For HMC, we have another kind of ways to circumvent this problem, but this is not the subject of this talk, unfortunately. Okay, so this is summary of the first half of the talk. We have spikes in QMC, and they can be quantitatively qualitatively described as heavy tail distributions. And these heavy tail distributions, they are caused by zeros of determinant, and we can even connect mathematically dimensionality of zeros of determinant with power loss in these heavy tail distributions. Now let's have a look into algorithms which can be used to alleviate a bit this problem. We still have actually 1 degree of freedom in our algorithm. As I said, in usual QMC code, for example, in ALF, we first update all auxiliary fields inside given time slice, and then we compute observables inside this time slice. However, this is not the only way to make synchronization between updates and computations of observables. Here it's a bit of notation. This standard scheme, I will name it as T local scheme. It means that a computation of observables is synchronized by is synchronized with updates of auxiliary fields only at the level of time slices. Formally, it can be described like this. This is configuration in nth sweep after update of auxiliary field at site I in space and in Euclidean time slice tau. Now we do updates for the whole time slice. That's why this index here is V. And then we use this configuration to compute all observables in the same, in the same time slice. But this is not the only way to do things. For example, we can use global scheme. That's typical, for example, for HMC. Here we first update all auxiliary fields in all time slices, and then we compute observables again in all time slices after full update of the fields. It means that for computation of observables here, we actually use configuration after after full update of fields in space and in time. This is so-called global scheme. So it has less synchronization between updates and computation of observables. And finally, ST local scheme. Here it has more synchronization between updates of fields and computation of observables. Because here we update local observable. Well, think about double occupancy, for example, after update of the field at current time slice and at current site in space. For example, here, red arrow, we update auxiliary fields at time, at time slice tau and site I in space, and then we compute double occupancy immediately after this update at the same site in space I and at the same time slice tau. It is also written here in this form. So both indexes are the same. Spatial index is the same and time index is the same. And this we name as ST local scheme. And main statement is that's so average is the same, but distribution and thus error bars are substantially different for different ways of synchronization between updates and computation of observables. Well, in principle, it can be understood even in some small toy model. I added here several slides about it, but they're actually mathematically loaded, so I will probably just briefly run through them. Yeah, we can just take simple two-dimensional toy model with probability distribution, which includes Gaussian part and something which models fermionic determinant with domain walls. For simplicity, this function can be just line in two-dimensional plane, and that's why we have this domain walls. For example, here two domain walls and here two domain walls. And then again, we can have local observables concentrated around X1 and X2. And then we can model global and local updates. Global update means that we first update both fields X1 and X2, and then compute both observables O1 and O2. And local scheme means that we first update X1, then measure O1, then update X2 and measure O2. And yeah, after some math, one can derive explicitly distributions for observable O, which is O1 plus O2 divided by 2. In both cases, this is for the case when we have global scheme, and this is for the case when we have local scheme. And evidently, these distributions are different. And if you plot them, then the effect can already be noticed. Okay, we start from the case when X1 and X2 are independent. Then, of course, well, as a check of computations, if they're independent, then of course, difference between global and local schemes is absent. They're simply equivalent because different dimensions, in this case, X1 and X2, they simply do not feel each other. But if they are not independent, it means that this domain walls are not perpendicular to each other. For example, we have situation like here. Then we can already notice that these two expressions for distributions of observables, they already give different answers. And for global update, when we first update both fields and then measure both observable, distribution is slightly wider. So average is the same, of course. So here already the effect is noticeable. And then we can do the same. Well, of course, not theoretically, but just numerically for real Hubbard model. We can look at different observables, charge and spin fluctuations inside sublattice. This observable, they are not strictly speaking local because they include long range correlators, but still they are concentrated in one time slice. They are computed from equal time fermionic propagator. And then double occupancy, which is strictly local. And obviously, since determinant of equal time fermionic propagator is just inverse of fermionic determinant, then at zeros of fermionic determinant, we have these observables, we have explosions for these observables. Okay, and now distributions. They are based again on individual values of observables after one sweep. What we see here, we did it here for 6 by 6 by 256 lattice. It's Hubbard model hexagonal lattice U equal to 5, so that we are in antiferromagnetic phase. And we compare all three different setups for synchronization. Okay, global scheme is the worst one. It has the heaviest tails. And the worst statistical fluctuations, the same as for the toy model. Then we have T-local scheme, which is substantially better, especially for spin, for example. But for charge fluctuations, it's better too. But T-local scheme, which I repeat, is used now in all QMC algorithms, is not the best. We can further reduce statistical fluctuations significantly. And for example, here in ST-local scheme, distributions are more narrow for basically all observables we look at, for spin fluctuations, for charge fluctuations, for double occupancy, and for this squared staggered moment. For ST-local case, distributions are always narrower. We can look at the same effects on different lattices. When we increase lattice size, it's 12 by 12 here in comparison with 6 by 6. When we go to continuum limit and when we look also at square lattice, just to prove that it doesn't depend on type of the lattice. And what we can see is that the effect actually increases when we increase lattice size. Just compare this plot for 12 by 12 and this plot also from blue and red histograms for 6 by 6 lattice. Evidently, here the difference is significantly larger than in this case. Also, the effect is a bit larger on square lattice, and the effect diminishes at continuum limit when we have the same inverse temperature, but two times larger number of steps in Euclidean time. It's actually connected to phenomena that local updates are like less important in this case. We update less, like smaller part of the whole field configuration. But okay, it's actually more complicated subject, and I probably do not have time to explain it in details. Anyway, the effect increases with increased lattice size, and it is the same on square and hexagonal lattice. So it's probably just the same on any bipartite lattice anyway. And if you look at tails, if we fit tails with power law, we see that actually distribution is still heavy tailed, even in ST local scheme, we still have heavy tail power law decay. It simply means that we did not decrease the power in the power law, but we decreased prefactor in this power law. So here is the summary of the second part of the talk, that these spikes or heavy tail distributions, they are very dependent on the way how we synchronize updates and computation of observables. And this so-called T-local scheme, or how I call it, which is currently employed in QMC codes and, for example, in ALF, is actually not the best one. One can do better synchronization. Well, one can also do worse, for example, as in global updates, but our aim is to do something better. And if we make ST local synchronization so that updates and computation of observables is synchronized both in space and time, then statistical fluctuations are substantially smaller. And mathematically, it corresponds to decrease of prefactor in heavy tail distributions. And now let's quantify this effect, because okay, we have less fluctuations, but what does it mean from computational point of view? Because in the end, we want smaller error bars, or alternatively, we want to spend less computer resources achieving the same error bar. And here the last peculiarity plays a role. Because, as I said, in heavy tail distributions, central limit theorem doesn't work. And the error bar is actually not proportional to inverse square root of statistics. And we need to employ more elaborate statistical procedures to make valid estimates of the error bar. And one can see that actually, if we increase statistics and we look at average, not over one sweep, but average over n sweeps, for example, 25 or 100 sweeps, then the distribution still remains heavy tail. So that even with increased statistics or with some kind of binning, we cannot actually get rid of heavy tails. So that we still, so that central limit theorem will still not work. This heavy tail, they propagate throughout any binning procedure. Okay, so then which algorithm do we use in the end for computation of error bars? Our aim is to estimate error bar in the simulation with n sweeps. And in order to make like stricter estimation of the error bar, we actually expand statistics and repeat this simulation with n sweeps m times, so that in the end we have m times n sweeps. Then we compute true average. It's average over all m simulations with n sweeps each. And for each simulation with n sweeps, we compute current average. This is average for one simulation with n sweeps. And then we study distributions of this average. Like here, for example, one can see that this is a distribution for averages over 25 sweeps. And this is distribution for the averages over 100 sweeps. Of course, if you have increased number of sweeps inside one simulation, then distribution becomes more and more narrow. Still, it's still heavy tailed, of course, but of course the error bar decreases. Now, which quantities can be used to estimate the error bars? It's a standard confidence interval. Basically, here is definition of it. Then it's 95% credible interval. In some sense, it's simpler because we simply take this distribution for averages over simulations in this case and cut 2.5% from the left and from the right. And then average variance. We simply compute variance inside each simulation and then average over all simulations. Now let's have a look at the dependence of all these estimators for error bar on the size of statistics. Here we have different schemes, ST local and T local scheme. Well, global scheme is very bad, so we do not even consider it here. Different observable. Here, observables. Here it's charge fluctuations, spin fluctuations, and double occupancy. Essentially, picture is the same, that we have power law decrease of error bars, of basically all estimators for error bars, average variance, confidence, or credible interval. But this power law decay is not inverse square root. It is actually slower. Well, it's direct consequence that we have power law in the distributions instead of exponential decay. All these estimators, they behave quite, they're quite close to each other. Yeah, basically difference between them is maybe like 20-30% at least. That's why there is, we can choose any of them basically to estimate the error bar in the end, and we made choice towards confidence interval. Okay, let's Well, yeah, this is a complicated question. In principle, I think, yeah, it's possible, but...
maybe I'll repeat the question. Maybe not everyone will get the chat.
Yes. So the question is, can you relate mu with the exponent psi of the distribution? I think it's possible, but it's probably complicated mathematically, because mu is dependent not only on power in the power law, but also on prefactor. It is evident here, because in ST local scheme and T local scheme, you can see that mu is different, while power law is the same. I mean, the power is the same, but prefactor is different. So it's complicated, unfortunately. I didn't do it, but yeah, I think it's possible if one thinks about it further. And then these are summarizing plots. Here we used 95% confidence interval as our estimate for the error bar, and we compare different schemes for synchronization, global, T local, and ST local, and we plot the dependence of error bar on the size of statistics. One can see that global scheme is just bad. Error bar at the same statistics, and it means that exactly at the same computational time is maybe 10 times, well, not 10 times, 5 times larger than the standard T local scheme. But T local scheme, it's a blue curve here and blue curve here. It's not the best. Well, T local scheme, I can repeat it once again. It's the standard for present day QMT. For example, ALF would be here at blue curve. If we employ ST local scheme for synchronization, then we have substantial reduction of the error bars at the same statistics. It means that at the same computational time spent on the simulation. Essentially, if you look at just increased region here between 0 and 20, then we see that reduction of the error bar, if we use ST local scheme in comparison with standard QMC, would be approximately 2.5-3 times. And what is even more important is that if we look at fits, power law fits for the errors, then the error bar for ST local scheme, it decays a little bit faster with the size of statistics in comparison with T local scheme. It means that the smaller error bar, the larger is speed up, which we have from the usage of ST local scheme. And this speed up can finally be quantified using this kind of dependence. It's speed up depending on relative error of the observable. Here we plot only for 6x6 lattice. For larger lattice, for 12x12 lattice, speed up will be even larger because the effect increases on larger lattice and for different observables. So if relative error is around 1%, well, that's more or less typical for our simulations. Maybe actually it's nice to have even smaller error bars. Then for observables which include long range correlators in space, observables which are not strictly local, speed up is, well, it varies from 5 to 10. Basically. For observables which contain spin degrees of freedom, it's a little bit smaller. For observables which contain charge degrees of freedom, it's somewhat larger than 10. But for strictly local observables like double occupancy, speed up can be really substantial. It can be up to 2 orders of magnitude. And as another practical example of speed up, here is computation of spatial correlator of charge. And here we have the same statistics, so the same computational time is spent. But here we use a usual T-local scheme for synchronization, so that usual QMC would be here. And here is ST-local scheme. And evidently, one can see that we can trace correlator somewhat further than in usual T-local computations. Imagine one fits this correlator with exponent, and of course, fit with exponent here would be, I would say, much nicer than in this case. We will simply have more points for this fit. And here is final summary for my talk. Yeah, basically it includes summaries for previous parts and for the last part that we simply showed that proper statistical processing shows that central limit theorem doesn't work. Error bar is not proportional to inverse square root of statistics. It decays slower, but still variance can be used as a good estimate for the error bar. And using this statistical processing, this rigorous estimation of error bar, we can estimate the speed up from employment of ST local scheme. And for strictly local observables like double occupancy, this speed up can actually reach even 2 orders of magnitude. This is summary for my talk. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much, Maxim. That was a very clear presentation. Any questions?
Can I still make some questions?
Of course.
So
there's no quota.
Yeah.
No size. So in the ST local, you are doing an update in space at a given time slice in space, and then you measure, right?
Yes.
Doesn't this mean that the measurements you are doing are more autocorrelated? Because you do a very little change and then you measure again. So I suppose there is an autocorrelation time which is bigger.
Well, first of all, we simply measured autocorrelation time and it did not increase. At least if we look at autocorrelation times for these histories of observables after full sweep through the after full sweep through the through the configuration.
So and, you in any case and you sum average entire over entire sweeps. That's what you're saying.
Yes.
I see.
And I'm actually not sure that this kind of arguments work for autocorrelation because fermionic determinants are quite non-local. And it's hard to say that in this case we have a different behavior for autocorrelation. Just because the number of updates for auxiliary fields is essentially the same in all the schemes, so that we put the same kind of uncertainty in configurations, the same degree of uncertainty in configurations. Summarizingly, we checked this autocorrelation and it didn't increase. And I'm not sure how we can estimate variation of autocorrelation from this kind of qualitative arguments.
I see. Thank you.
So you're saying that this is a big improvement that you get for free? There's no disadvantage?
Yes, for this case, yes. Well, downside is that I'm not sure how it will work for other models. I checked it for Hubbard model basically on bipartite lattices, on square and hexagonal lattice. And so there is no guarantee at all that it will work for another models.
I mean, independently of that, if you have the fat tail, one has to do a different analysis. That's what you were saying in the end. I suppose that it will be implemented right away because we are already a trivial parallelization over M course, no?
Sorry, could you repeat last sentence?
No, what I'm saying is that we should do the error analysis differently, right?
Yes. This could be done without
much effort because our program is already M parallelized in the different cores.
Well, okay. Error analysis, of course, can be implemented in different way. That's not a problem because error analysis simply needs the same data which we already have in ALF, for example, simply history of observables after each sweep. But main point is not error analysis itself, but this different synchronization. And I think from present set of data we have as output of ALF, we cannot squeeze out of it ST local results. Because computation of observables is made inside ALF in different manner. Some changes in the code are still needed.
Right, but even keeping the not an optimal scheme, we should do different analysis. That's what I understood.
Ideally, yes. Yeah, heavy tail distributions, they really need a different type of statistical analysis.
How many M do you need to have to distinguish sensibly this 95 interval?
Here I usually had around 100 M. I think it would be enough already to see some deviations. But things are not that bad. I mean that if you look at history of different estimates for the error bars, you see that confidence interval, credible interval, and variance, they actually behave more or less the same. And it means that we can actually use this variance as it is written here, but we simply should not expect that this variance it decays as inverse square root of statistic size. It decays much slower. So in principle, if we do not look at rigorous confidence interval, we can still use variance. But this variance it just behaves in different way.
I see. Thank you.
Can I ask you a question? Hi, Maxim.
Hi.
So you see, now I am like a postdoc to enter your ALF conference. Maybe not even postdoc. Okay. Bachelor students. I'm not even a master in this field. But and unfortunately, I just miss. I came to half of your talk. So sorry, maybe for stupid question. And I understand you're discussing continuous field or it doesn't matter if it's a discrete field to continue. So, let me say general question. So if everything is good, you have Hubbard model, half field, square lattice.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have then this your problem of heavy tails or not?
It depends on the channel you use for Hubbard-Statonovich decomposition.
I understand, but if you use the standard Hirsch decomposition,
then in principle, your distributions are still heavy tailed, but prefactor in this heavy tail is so small that it's actually even hard to notice it.
Okay, we agree that we start with something which is good. Then if you have a four field,
I may not agree. I may not agree, Maxime. I mean, mm-hmm. if you look at the standard as Alec Sasha says, mm-hmm. and then you look at the XY correlation function, spin,
mm-hmm.
then they have a very fat tail distribution. It's very hard.
Then I take it back because I probably didn't check it. Yeah. So yes, as Fakir said, even mm-hmm. in this channel, for some observables, we can have heavy tails. Yeah.
Okay, good. Then, for example, do you have feeling if you compare this starting from two Hirsch field to four, like in Alf, do you increase this problem? Or
you mean two or four valued discrete fields?
Yes.
It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's specifically why I included this backup slide, because I expected this question.
Okay, good.
It doesn't even matter if you have continuous or discrete fields.
Mm-hmm.
Here, for example, is comparison. You have here it's four valued discrete fields, exactly the one used in ALF. And on the right, it's HMC, so continuous auxiliary field with some additional tricks, exactly as Francesca asked, to overcome ergodicity issues, to simulate on only important symbols, so to say. But yes, that's some details which are not relevant here. And you can see that distributions are exactly the same. It means that this problem, it does not depend on the nature of auxiliary field, whether it's two-valued discrete, four-valued discrete, or continuous. It will be all the same.
Okay, sorry, and what is an x-axis? Maybe I'm completely stupid.
Okay, because it was explained in the beginning.
No, because y q squared can be negative, so it's a complex field.
Yeah, but average is of course possible, but for each particular configuration, it can be negative. This is okay.
We can talk later. I understand. I will be delighted to talk to you in some small this breaking
room.
That's fine.
We can talk later.
But my feeling. Maybe I will ask maybe some general question, because I come in from different communities, yeah. Mm-hmm. And in this diagrammatic Monte Carlo, God knows what, continuous time Monte Carlo, there is a different scheme, yeah. It's known that it's very hard to calculate average Green function or average correlation, and sometimes you use method which Prokofiev just started. It's called the worm algorithm, yeah, just to increase mm-hmm. your possibility to go from one space to another space. So is this is a reason of this problem or God knows what? Because I still don't understand. Because from my point of view, it's very strange method. Yeah. sorry, of course. So mm-hmm. So I'm thinking very simple. You have N atoms and L times, yeah? You have your O matrix. And Green function is O minus one. If I want to calculate Green, so for example, green function average, I need first to invert matrix and then calculate the average. You want to tell me, no, 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 I will do this, how it's called, space to space. What is your this?
Point to point, as your local, yeah, point to point, in space and
point. Yeah, but this is, in principle, strictly speaking, is against inversion of this green function matrix global, yeah?
Well, you know, no, yeah, but in this auxiliary field QMC, just algorithmically, if you look into its details, after each update of auxiliary field, we actually can reconstruct corresponding values of green function.
Only locally.
So it's yes, locally. Locally, well, we can also reconstruct further, but it will simply cost some.
That I understand. Okay, but if I want to calculate this non-local correlator, this will not help, yeah.
Well, that's for. Okay, for time the space correlators, I did not make any estimates because it will need some changes in algorithms. But for correlators in space, still I have some improvement, as you can see here in the last. In the last slides, let me go there. So that T local computation is a bit worse, still a bit worse than ST local. Yeah, for example, here these points are already below the error bars, but here we can still see some values. What we do here is imagine we have. Correlator in space. It's then we have two points correlator between source and sink, for example. And when we update auxiliary field, so yeah, we compute this correlator when we update auxiliary field at source and at sink. And this is now what I name as ST local synchronization for this kind of spatial correlators. And as you can see here, it is still a bit better than computation of these correlators after whole update of time slice.
Okay, very, very good. Did you think, once again, coming back to Prokofiev and do you heard about this worm algorithm?
Yeah.
If it's equivalent, because I remember 20 years ago all this nice talk by Kolya Prokofiev, and he said very simple: if you use this antiperiodic in time boundary conditions, then you stick. Yeah, it's very hard to go through all your phase space. What Worm algorithm did? So he introduced this exactly source. So he just break this space-time invariance and go with the green function, and green function can jump over phase space much easy. At the end, he restores this periodic boundary or anti-periodic boundary condition, and so God knows what. So, in other words, I can tell you. So in continuous time. You have a many possibility, yeah? Or you calculate partition function Z, and then the weight will be one unity. You sum in one unity. You can calculate the green function. The best possibility that the weight will be proportional to green function. So it means that what you want to measure, you update your weights in the best way what you want to measure. This is idea of this worm algorithm in continuous green function. I'm not sure how it's translated to your idea that this ST local is better than.
But what Sasha let me be sure that I understand what you're saying. And of course, if you sample the observable, right, rather than sampling the partition function, then you will get rid of these tails.
Yes.
Right. Is that correct?
Probably. That's what I mean.
That's what you
mean. Well, observable doesn't have zeros. So.
The observable doesn't have zeros, but let's say that you observable exactly what you want to measure, right?
Yes.
So I'm trying to.
No, I don't know how to.
The worm algorithm is not the motivation of the worm algorithm. Is what you said before. You expand if you want the configuration space, right?
Yes.
And then and you have configurations which have a worm, which have sort of word lines which are disconnected, and you know you have the heads and the tails. They move around, and at one point they meet again. Mm-hmm. When they meet, you have a configuration which contributes to the partition function.
Yeah.
It's a very efficient way, if you want, of going through the configuration space. I am not 100% sure that I know how to translate this idea.
This is my question to Michael. So if you have some equivalent, maybe not.
Well, okay.
Martin.
Actually, I did a bit of simulations which are equivalent to what you are telling. But this is different to what I'm talking here about. Mm-hmm. I mean, in principle, since the reason, let me go back to the slide. It should be. Next. It's very slow. Yeah, this slide. In principle, it is all connected because these spikes, they are caused by zeros of determinants. So essentially, yeah, we are dealing with the same regions in configuration space, and idea which I'm exploiting here is a bit different from what you are telling me. Here, the idea is that simply these local updates. They, at least for this model, they effectively pushing us away from these domain walls, or here they are more pronounced from these domain walls, because I mean that imagine here this direction. It corresponds to some localized field configuration. And it means that local update of the field in the center of this localized field configuration will be almost perpendicular to this domain wall. It will drive us in this direction. Mm-hmm. So it will be very effective in removal of spikes in fermionic observables, again, somewhere around the region of center of this localized field configuration.
Okay.
So this is what I'm using here. But what you are telling me is that we can get rid of this domain walls by inclusion of observables into the weight we are using for generation of configuration.
Yeah.
This is I did not include the slides here, but I actually did it. It can be done in HMC too. It was one of the ideas how to make HMC better, but I simply didn't proceed too far with it due to lack of time and so on. Let me.
No, but I understand. Yeah, we'll talk later, so I don't want to over.
You can talk about it later. I have a couple of slides about it, but not in this presentation.
Okay, good.
But don't you get the same problem when you do that? I mean, you include an observer, which can be also negative.
No, I don't. Well, of course, observable can be negative, but I include modulus of observable, of course.
I see.
In the way it's actually possible. I even have a fully written algorithm for it. It is working, but I need to launch tests to see how it works and so on. So
I see
it's another subject, but in principle it's possible.
Can I ask one or two more questions? So first of all, I'm a little bit surprised by your slide where you said that discrete versus continuous fields doesn't make a difference. Because as you also see in this slide currently, the domain walls and the tails originates from determinants of zeros. Wouldn't you expect that if you have discrete fields, so first of all, that the domain walls or the lines of zeros need some fine tuning in the auxiliary field to be right on the line. And if you discretize it, shouldn't you expect that you can jump across and you don't hit the zero? So the effective dimensionality of your domain wall should be at least appearing to be smaller, and then the power should be changing. Why is this not the case?
Can I start to answer?
Sure. Yes.
Okay. This is exactly what I thought before I started this activity. I exactly thought like this, that domain walls, they have dimensionality n minus one. So they are like points on the line. And that's why if you have discrete fields, we do not encounter them. And then these distributions will be very different.
Yeah.
So that's just the fact. I mean, experimentally, distributions are equivalently heavy tailed, both for discrete and continuous. So now we only should try to explain this fact, because it's simply how it is. And explanation is actually non-trivial, and I am afraid I don't even have full explanation for it. I think it is connected to, we even had, Fahir, if you remember, we had a long discussion about it, and we have different hypotheses.
My cheap answer would be Gauss-Hermite. You just do the discrete versions we have is an approximation to the continuum. If delta tau gets small, then essentially the two should be equivalent if you just use the Gauss-Hermite mapping, if you want, between discrete and continuous. That's a cheap way of saying that. That's a cheap way, but it's an okay way of seeing it, right? You should.
No, I don't agree.
Okay.
Why should this be the case? Because for a given delta tau, you would still have the field on the time slice, and it's still a continuous variable, and I still have to tune it to find the zero. And if I have discrete fields, I don't hit it. I missed the zero because the value that I'm sampling is not there.
Yes. This is unfortunately the problem.
When your delta tau gets small, you have more fields, right? You have just more fields. So when you change one field, the net effect is smaller.
It is something connected much more to increase dimensionality.
You increase the dimensionality, right? So you're getting to it. So that's too simple what you're saying. So I think that this would work. I mean, mathematically, this will happen at one point. Mathematically, you will be able to go from the continuous field to the to the discrete one. That will be exact. There will be an exact mapping in the delta tau limit.
So you're essentially saying that with the making delta tau small, making delta tau large, you have discrete tuning knobs, but you have so many discrete tuning knobs that they almost start looking continuous.
And so you start from this point where you have the equivalent. equivalence, at least it's a reference point. That's the way I would think about it. And then you start doing, okay, delta tau, and there will be, of course, there will be subtle differences at finite delta tau between a discrete field and a continuous. What Maxime experimentally is saying is that, well, numerically is saying that it's the difference is not very large, right?
Yeah.
So that we're close to the delta tau limit zero.
Yeah, but I suspect that there is actually some non-trivial mathematics behind it. So it's actually non-trivial point, which I do not fully understand, I must admit.
I see. Then I had another question. Maybe you're aware of the trick, which is it's going in a similar direction like the reweighting scheme when you include the observable in the sampling weight. But there is this trick where at least people claim that this works, is where you add an artificial time slice. So you set up your temperature, inverse temperature beta, your delta tau, you calculate L trot, but then you sample L trot plus one time slices and you average over the third, this additional time slice. So you really do an explicit sum over the fields. And the idea there is that, okay, assuming that you didn't have a sign problem, then even with the additional time slices, you always have positive configurations. If I now sum over all the fields in this additional time slice, I have a sum of positive numbers or non-negative numbers. And the chances that all of the fields on this additional time slice average to zero. Oh, well, not the fields, but the weight average still to zero is small, or it needs fine tuning. Shouldn't this regularize the zeros of the determinant and thereby get rid of the domain walls?
I vaguely remember this papers, but I must admit I read it too long ago. So it was essentially introduced to fight with sign problem.
No,
sign problem. It was introduced to fight the heavy tails. Mm-hmm. That's the whole purpose of this additional time.
I think you sent me once this paper.
Yes, it's a Shiwei time. It's Shiwei's paper. Basically,
yes.
He was doing that. Senju, I think you tried this, you told me once, right? You tried to implement, Senju, I think you're around. You tried to implement Shiwei's method. Is that correct?
That was many years ago. Yeah, I remember that at that time it didn't work. Yeah.
I don't know. I never tried it myself. So I don't know. We never studied it. The data would
eventually time slice.
The data presented in the paper is only for u equals two, right?
Yeah.
It was for very small.
For u equal two, I can say that actually from this kind of. This kind of instanton gas model, at least for Hubbard model, for u equal to two, one actually will not even see the domain wall because the dominant symbol or dominant local minimum will be simply vacuum.
But Johannes,
that wasn't there.
Yes.
Johannes, did you try it?
At u equal two, everything will work.
I was looking into it. There was one step conceptual where they brushed over some of the formulas, which I found more challenging to actually implement. So no, I didn't try.
Okay.
Because they say it's trivial to know the Green's function that you would get if you ignored the time slice. And I was looking at the formula and I didn't see the trivial part of the statement. And then I would actually, if I still am allowed to ask a question, would have a third question.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, how important is the, I'm talking about the ST synchronized measurements. Mm-hmm. How important is the correlation between the update and the measurement, because I understand that when you do this ST synchronization, you're essentially kind of redefining what a time slice is, and you don't measure when, since you take the Green's function at this position, you don't measure the when you have the full propagation of, you know, if you have the symmetric way e to the minus delta tau half t, all the interaction operators e to the minus delta tau half t, but you're somewhere in the operator chain. So the question is, what is more important, being close to the operator where you take the measurement from, or having the synchronization between the spin flip and the measurement?
I think the larger one is important. Yeah, synchronization between spin flips and measurements. Yeah.
The intuition is very simple, right? Because for the simple Hubbard model, the acceptance is proportional to the local Green's function.
Yeah, this argument.
So when the local Green's function is next to zero, acceptance will be very low. So you sort of avoid the spike if you measure it right afterwards. That's all.
I see. When you start changing the other fields.
Yeah. So the clue, what Maxime's idea is beautiful, but the truth is, Maxime, that's what my thought, is that it's a very special purpose thing for a Hubbard model for the moment. Is that a correct statement, Maxime?
Yeah, we didn't check it for anything else.
But there are many complications.
Just we can't say.
Right. But I mean, so you just flip the field next to I and tau, and then you measure all the correlation functions which have to do with this site I.
Yeah.
Right? And then you sort of damp the possibility of having a spike.
If you were to continue and do a few further updates on different sites for the Hubbard interaction, the Green's function can go smaller and you get closer to the zeros and the potential times. I see.
The intuition is rather simple for the Hubbard one. The problem is that if you have a bigger, you said this operator chain. For us, it's in the Hubbard model, because all the local interactions, they commute with each other, then everything's okay, right? But then if you have bigger interactions, then you start having headaches, how to do the measurements, right? Because that means you flip in the operator chain, but then if you measure, you don't have the Green's function, which you need at hand, right?
Well, depends on what you define as a Green's function. The point where we define a time slice is a bit arbitrary, isn't it?
But if I define the... But I will have to define the Green's. So I will have a different definition of the Green's function for different positions.
Yes. If I'm not careful. Which might be tricky.
Which makes you a bit uncomfortable, right? Which makes you a bit uncomfortable. That's all. So you have to think about that. So there are a lot of add-ons to this idea, which are, I think, not so trivial, and actually not so trivial to implement in a generic way. So that's why this idea has not found its way in ALF yet, right?
Yeah. No, that would have been the advantage of the additional time slice, because this is fairly generic. Mm-hmm. It doesn't depend on the observable. It's like you don't do the reweighting scheme with the absolute value of, say, the spin correlations or the density correlations or whatever you want to do. But I never tried it, so I don't know if it works. If it works well, and you can again say that if you go to the limit of delta tau going small, it's like one time slices and of very, very many and infinitely many in the limit of delta tau going to zero. So maybe you turn a zero into an infinitely small epsilon, which may not help that much. But I don't know. I haven't tried. Yeah. Sorry for taking more time. Thanks for answering the question, Maxime.
No problem.
I'll stop the recording now, and we thanks Maxime and we continue the discussion.